This program is part of WQED's Pittsburgh History Series.
One, two, three. Ho, ho, ho. Yes, it's that time of year. It's December 2020, and you know, it's not like other years. We're in the middle of this pandemic, and all sorts of happy events have been canceled, trying to stem the spread of this virus, COVID-19. But here at WQED, we have lots of video reminders of other years when it made more sense to get together and party and socialize and celebrate Christmas and Hanukkah and Kwanzaa and all sorts of things. Friendship, love, light, food and drink. But we're being careful this year. I'm Rick Sebak. I'm on my front porch. And over the next hour, I want to share with you some recipes, some music, some clips from various holiday programs. And we're calling this a Ho 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 Healthy Holidays Hodgepodge. And we may have a few special guests, like the Red Beans and Rice Combo, who are playing right now. You can see on the left, Wayno, who's a jazz vocalist and great cartoonist, sitting next to Tom Roberts at the piano. And on the other side of the WQED-FM studio is Dave Klug on percussion. Of course, we may throw in a pledge break or two, but you know, generosity and giving are big parts of the holiday season. And if it's all right, I thought we might start with the beginning, the tease, from the program Happy Holidays in Pittsburgh. It'll remind you of a lot of things that people do around here to celebrate lots of things in non-pandemic years.
At the end of every year, as the days grow short, the world around Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania can seem gloomy and bleak. As things turn cold, people here, as everywhere in this part of the Northern Hemisphere, run the risk of turning gray, afraid that light and warmth may never come again.
Deck the halls with bars of holly.
But since ancient times, people have worked and partied hard to fight the darkness. People use lights and celebrations, decorations and family gatherings to brighten the early winter nights.
My dad said there was no such thing as an ugly girl or an ugly Christmas tree.
We saw the downtown lights. In those days, department stores had wonderful, wonderful windows in them.
And at least since Europeans and other non-natives started staying in western Pennsylvania, the arrival of winter has been brightened by a variety of cultural activities.
I remember that my grandmother used to give us underwear and socks.
We just put up a tree in our house and just kind of just go with the Christmas spirit.
Gives food and fun, you know what I mean?
When we were kids, you know, when the house started to smell like fish, we knew Christmas was coming.
We're going to look at some of the things that people do in the Pittsburgh area to observe holy days and to help brighten the long nights as one year ends and the next begins. And not just Christmas stuff. There's Hanukkah, Kwanzaa, and at the start of the 21st century, Ramadan fell at this time of year too. So we're going to look at a lot of activities connected to this time of year. We'll check out some history and a few traditions.
It's a big tradition just to wait in line.
I don't think Pittsburgh realizes what a treat it is to have this artifact on view every year.
And we're going to call this program Happy Holidays in Pittsburgh. Now, obviously, we can include only a sampling of the zillions of things that are done at this time of year, but we always hope that there will be more shows like this one. Because it is such a great time of year, in spite of the shortened days.
It's just a nice time when it's dark and it's cold outside in the winter to light a candle.
And there's plenty to see and do all around the city.
Should be snowing!
Wow, that is an opening sequence. And you know, I have to say thank you to Kevin Conrad, who was the editor on that, and the editor on most of my programs here at WQED. But it really puts you in the holiday spirit. Now, we shot that show in 2001, and we first released it in the holiday season of 2002. It was then 98 minutes long. In 2003, we cut it down to 60 minutes, and through PBS, we offered it to other stations. It quickly became the one episode of the Pittsburgh History Series that has aired in more cities across the country than any other. And we even made an ornament, a souvenir ornament that went with the show, It has the title and Santa on one side. And I love an ornament that has the date. And if you can look really closely here, it says WQED 2002. And now it's a collector's item and still in the package. But, you know, Pittsburghers know that the holiday season in Pittsburgh really kicks off the Friday before Thanksgiving, when everybody wants to go downtown to curse the darkness and to light some lights. It didn't really happen this year. There was a virtual version, but people didn't go. And it's still fun to look at things that used to happen or that will happen again. And watch this.
Really, the thing that officially kicks off the city's holiday season is Light Up Night. Always a Friday evening in November, before Thanksgiving, organized by the Pittsburgh Downtown Partnership. Tens of thousands of people come to the downtown area to see all the buildings lit up, to mingle with crowds, to hear performers, and to see some of the holiday decorations, maybe some bright surprises. The giant tree decoration on the corner of Stanwix and Penn is officially called the Unity Tree. But lots of Pittsburghers still call it the Horns Tree, after the old department store that was in that building until 1995. Horns began this whole big tree on the corner tradition in 1953, and there's been one here every year since, except for 1978, when to save energy, it didn't get put up. But Light Up Night is also when the Tree of Lights in Queen State Park is turned on, a holiday gift from Duquesne Light. And all the activities are capped by fireworks, bringing light to the darkness, too. Actually, at this time of year, whenever there's an event or a parade, like this community celebration in Greenfield, you're likely to find fireworks exploding at some point or another.
Merry Christmas with fireworks. We Pittsburghers love our fireworks. And still they are light when these nights are so long, and that's what's important. And we put that together in 2001 and 2002. 13 years later, we went back to Light Up Night when we were making a program called Return to Downtown Pittsburgh. It was a suggestion as well as a sequel to our 1992 program called Just Downtown Pittsburgh. This time, we actually met Jeremy Waldrop, president and CEO of the Pittsburgh Downtown Partnership, and some of his great colleagues.
We want, what, like 5,000 of these? The Pittsburgh Downtown Partnership was formed in 1994 to really focus on the economic vitality of downtown Pittsburgh. So we provide a whole host of clean and safe services, as well as programming, from farmers markets to night markets to big festivities like Light Up Night.
Today is Light Up Night!
Which brings over 300,000 people into the center of the city to kick off the holiday season.
The lights, fireworks.
Just the energy of the people.
I come to Light Up Night every year.
We came to have fun.
So we encourage all the building owners for this one time a year to turn all the lights on.
We try to make it a family tradition every year to come down. It's very nice.
We have 9 tree lightings and ceremony dedications.
I love the Light Up Night, and I love being here with all the excitement, and the people are happy.
We're all Pittsburghers tonight. Enjoy our home.
God bless.
See you.
Things like the Horns Department Store tree, which is now the Unity tree, has been lighting up for over 60 years.
Oh, that's cool.
It's been about 2 years, but I figure, you know, they're older now. It's time to come back and remind them what, you know, Pittsburgh and Christmas is about. So
she made me come tonight.
I think this is the best way to get into the holiday spirit. I think every night's a great night to be downtown, but this truly is the way. It's just before Thanksgiving every year, so you may not quite have caught that Christmas bug yet, but this gives it to you, and it's a magical evening.
But there's much, much more than just lights. There's amazing music at Heinz Hall, and lots of laughs at the arcade comedy on Liberty.
A healthy platonic relationship between casual friends.
There are countless things to do and see. It's a celebration of the city as much as the season.
I think it's even better now than it was before.
Tonight I just wanted the energy.
Yeah. Did a little Christmas shopping, had a heck of a good time.
It is fun!
And of course, we end the night with fireworks.
There's a real sense of togetherness in Pittsburgh in general, but this time of year, it's just out of the world.
Yes, out of the world. Certainly out of our world today. But you know, we can hold out hope for 2021. Maybe by the holiday season, things will be getting back to normal. And we can consider again the idea of hundreds of thousands of people getting together to kick off a holiday downtown. In the meantime, we hope you're staying healthy. And we hope you might be thinking, gosh, how can I make sure that WQED can keep making programs like this? Well, it's really very simple. You may know the routine. You want to go to WQED.org and click on the donate button. Or you can simply call the number here on the screen. If you can donate at the $5 a month level, that's $60 a year, even if you can become a sustaining member at $5 a month, we have a new little thank you gift that we'd like to share with you. And it's from the Steel City Salt Company. And it is a small jar of cypress flake salt. Really beautiful salt. I've used it many times and it's really great, unusual, and I put it on top of my cookies. We also are offering with that a jar of Steel City Salt's eggnog spice. And it's a blend of spices. It's cane sugar, nutmeg, cinnamon, ginger, and clove. All, and you can just, you know, shake it lightly on top of your eggnog. You get both of these as a thank you gift at the $5 a month level. And, you know, it really is very easy to do. Just WQED.org on your computer. Click on the donate button. It'll explain everything you need to do. Or call this number on the screen. Either way, it's a way of saying happy holidays to WQED. And you know, this whole idea of holiday specials is not new at WQED. Having done a lot of research about Fred Rogers and having interviewed him, and actually having started my TV career in the 1970s with Josie Carey when she was working in South Carolina, I was really thrilled to find out that WQED had still preserved an early holiday special they did in the late 1950s. It was on a kinescope, which was a way of preserving television before there was videotape. And this show is called Josie's Holiday, produced by Fred Rogers, starring Josie Carey and Ernie Coombs. And you're going to hear Josie sing I Know It's Time for Christmas, which was the holiday song that she wrote the lyrics for and Fred Rogers wrote the music. And it's really fun. So, here's the opening of Josie's Holiday.
I'm Josie. Why, hi, how do you do?
Oh, how are you? And how are you fixed for Christmas spirit? Got a lot of that on hand? You know, we get so busy getting ready for Christmas that sometimes we don't really notice it around us and really appreciate it. We get so wrapped up in wrapping presents that we don't take time to look around us and enjoy the tree in the neighbor's house or the lights they've strung outside their house. Or the nice smile that people are smiling. If you look around, you can see Christmas everywhere. I know it's time for Christmas. I see it everywhere. I know it's time for Christmas. There's Christmas in the air. My mom is busy baking and nuts and spices. My dad has found a pine tree. My brother. Being nice, I see more signs of Christmas every day. The people smile, a special secret way.
I made a mistake. I thought that program was produced by Fred Rogers. But I was wrong. It was produced and written by a man named John Howard. Fred, of course, is the voice of all the puppets, including Daniel's striped tiger.
How's everything been down there at 25th and December?
Oh, everything is just fine. I've seen a lot of my friends. We're going caroling in a little while. Oh. Don't you love to go caroling? Christmas isn't Christmas without the carols.
No, I love to sing them too.
Wow, an old black and white TV special like that just has a special holiday magic. And maybe I'm just showing my age. But here at WQED, this whole tradition of holiday specials allows us to celebrate not just the holidays and music, but also the diverse communities and the different delicious traditions that people have brought to Pittsburgh from countries all over the world. In 2001, we spent an unforgettable evening in Oakland with the folks from the Latin American Cultural Union, also known as LACU.
We have the mothers prepare those costumes and teach their children, you know, how those are being made and that type of stuff. We have grandmothers that they are, you know, behind the scenes and all that kind of thing, trying to unite the family and represent their culture.
This Latin American event is being held in Oakland at the Frick International Studies Academy. Wayne Walters, originally from St. Thomas in the Caribbean, is the principal here.
We're here for the Fiesta de Navidad, which is a celebration of different cultural celebrations throughout this time of year in different Latin American countries.
We look forward to it the whole year.
Every year we try to share our holiday traditions with the Pittsburgh community.
We want the community to know who we are, express our culture by food, dancing, and music, and different type of activities.
Many of the activities here have been arranged by Juana Roman from Peru. She's the social coordinator for the Cultural Union.
Generally, every year we try to gather together every 200, 300 people, and they're very active in the community. Everybody anticipates the food, mainly because they are bringing from so many different countries.
Yes, from Peru and Mexico and Puerto Rico and Brazil, you know, from every country.
That's the beauty of it in Pittsburgh, because you see a variety of people from different Latin American countries that you even do not have access when you're down in Latin America, you know, to meet everybody.
I have seen, for example, that we have some tamales. You know, those are from Mexico, and that's a very special dish, yes. And also the dish that you saw that Salome was preparing, that's also a very special dish from Peru.
But you don't want to get too stuffed, because right after dinner, the dancing starts.
The dance program is a very important part for us because that's when everybody just feels the beat and everybody wants to get up and dance.
I know it's salsa merengue, but don't ask me to do it.
In the beginning, we're going to have a campesino dance. And this campesino dance is coming from the rural areas of Cuba. So generally, you are more familiar with montuno, cha-cha-cha, and all those kind of stuff. But this one is a really rural dance, and it's mainly being danced between a grandmother, the son, and grandchildren. So you're going to see them all in action, and that's how we're going to open the night in terms of dances. Then after that, we're going to have the chiloé, that it's also an Andean traditional dance for the holidays in Chile. After that comes the flamenco. The flamenco dancers are coming. They're going to do rumba flamenca, and after that, we're going to have a demonstration of tango, of classical tango. And just to finish with everything, we're going to have Santa Claus, because the kids live in America. They love Santa Claus, you know, so. And then after that, you have the big piñatas that everybody thinks that they're for birthdays, but they're actually for Christmas, for the holiday season. That's going to be our end of the evening.
Piñatas for Christmas. I'd forgotten about that. And all that dancing. What fun. And of course, you probably recognize that food is a crucial part of all those big celebrations. But this year, we may be making smaller portions because there won't be as many big parties. But we got to be careful, too, about the ingredients. Go for your ingredients early. Don't wait. Shop all during December. Order online if you can and go pick up. Support the merchants in the strip. But don't wait till the last minute, because we can't have a mob scene like that. We want to be able to go next year without fear of a virus, but we want to be there too. So in 2001, we went to the strip looking for crowds. We wanted to be squished together at Penn Mac waiting for cheese. You know, and some of the very best food in the city is all around the strip. You remember.
Like for us, it's like a family tradition. We come down here every year.
Oh, it's exciting. It's Christmas. You know, a lot of people's here.
This is a tradition. Even if I have to take off work, we do this. Up and down here.
It's crazy. That's why we like it.
Okay, folks, we're going to let you in about 3 minutes, okay?
Why don't you come in here and see the cheese counter? Come on.
Who's ever going to the cheese counter? Stay to the left.
I just love the place. I don't know if it's the cheese. Is this mine, hon?
Prosciutto. Buffalo mozzarella, we're gonna let some in now.
They hate me. They hate me.
Pepper cheese, Asiago, baby Swiss, and you're done.
I need Gouda.
Whoever wants out, because I'm the one that has to tell them to keep going to the left, and they're smushing in there.
Here's your Gouda. You want anything else?
I look forward to this every year.
This is Pittsburgh, and this is what we're about.
We eat and drink. I look forward to going into Penn Mac to smell the cheese, the bread.
Delicious.
If they can make an air freshener out of it, I'd put it in my car.
Everybody in the whole city of Pittsburgh comes here no matter what.
Then we walk up and down the strip and make fun of everybody.
In the strip, you can get what you need.
That's a bacala with the bone.
And then we wait in line for cheese.
Would you like to try some of our kielbasa homemade?
We wait in line for fish.
Oh, yeah, we saw a lot of smelt, squid.
These can grow to be 100 feet long.
It's the only place we don't wait in line.
They swim backwards.
We got pre-tested mistletoe guaranteed to work.
Water comes in here and goes out there, goes backwards. Squid.
A lot of customers come here and ask for the different cuts. They want some special cuts, thick cuts.
All kinds of fish. Now, you name it, we caught it.
Meatball, peppers, onion sauce, mystery cheese.
Yes, yes, yes.
Here we go, $4, honey.
Sausage flies out the door right now, and then we do a lot of slicing, as you can see. Build up good biceps.
Oh, it's just the atmosphere. It's Pittsburgh.
When you're in a hurry, it's difficult.
They put up with the crowds, the insanity.
But if you come down there with the idea you just want to have fun in the strip and get your foods, it's a lot of fun.
'Tis the season, right? I mean, this stuff is worth it, isn't it? Yeah. Thank you so much. Thank you.
Everybody's happy?
People are very generous.
And they're still smiling.
Sure, the people get upset about the crowds and the wait, but that's why God invented Zantac.
And it's fun. I mean, people love to be with people, really.
Wall-to-wall people today.
People are an attraction. The more people you have, the more people you get.
Yeah, it's nothing better than a Christmas time on the street. That's the big action here.
The spirit of Christmas is marvelous. All people, all religions.
Bah humbug.
It's probably one of the best days we've ever had for the holidays.
Not bad. Everybody's relatively happy.
Merry Christmas.
Buon Natale.
Salute.
Listen, if you go to the strip this year, wear a mask. Don't dawdle. Go early. Now, I'm the only person here on my front porch, so I can take the mask off, but I'm serious. Although I keep thinking of that guy there at the end who says, bah, humbug. Everybody knows a guy like that, a goofball, a turkey. Which reminds me of a trivia question that I like to ask at this time of year. What familiar holiday song includes the lyric, "Everybody knows a turkey"? I've asked my friend David Bennett to help give you the answer. David plays a mean cello, but during the pandemic, he's been having some fun with a ukulele.
Chestnuts roasting on an open fire, Jack Frost nipping at my nose, Yuletide carols being sung by a choir, and folks dressed up like Eskimos. Everybody knows a turkey and some mistletoe help to make the season bright. Tiny tots with their eyes all aglow will find it hard to sleep tonight. They know that Santa's on his way. He's loaded lots of cowboy cookies on his sleigh, and every mother's child will want to spy to see if reindeer really know how to fly. And so I'm offering this simple
Thanks, David Bennett. That was really nice. And you know, right now could be the perfect time for you to give us a call. Call the number on the screen or get on your computer and go to WQED.org, click on the donate button, and make a contribution to WQED so that we can continue to celebrate this city and all its celebrations. If you can pledge at the $5 a month level, which is a $60 annual gift, we have a special little thank you gift that we'd like to send to you. The folks over at the Steel City Salt Company have helped us put this together. We're calling it WQED's Season's Greetings. And you get a small container of eggnog spice, which is a combination of cane sugar, nutmeg, cinnamon, ginger, and clove. And you can sprinkle this on top of your eggnog for a really fine topper there. You also get a small container of cypress flake salt, which is really good. You could put on anything that uses salt. And the two of them together are the QED Season's Greetings. They are our small thank you gift to you if you can pledge at the $5 a month level, $60 a year. And we're going to try and send them out as quick as we can so that you might be able to use them during the holidays. We'll do it ASAP. Now, I've used this salt. I actually love this salt. I first found it in the Strip District when they had a table down there in the Strip when the Steel City Salt Company first began. Now they have a storefront as well over in Millvale. And you can stop and get this, but we want to send this to you as a thank you gift if you can pledge at that $5 a month level online or call the number on the screen. Either way, we appreciate your support. We count on your support, and we hope at this time of year you might be able to do that. Now, I actually do love to put salt on my cookies. I make pretty much one kind of cookie. David Bennett actually mentioned them in his version of a Christmas song. Santa was filling his sleigh with cowboy cookies. Those are my cowboy cookies. How about I share the recipe with you? I usually make these cookies just at Christmas time. But here in 2020, during the pandemic, I've been making them a lot more often. Some people have been making sourdough bread. I've been making oatmeal chocolate chip cookies. I like them to have as gifts to give to people who are nice to me. I like to send them to friends all over the country, just because we all could use a cookie. And I base all of this on my mother's old recipe. She called them cowboy cookies. But I've allowed myself to be more experimental, and I'm calling these COVID cowboy cookies because there are no rules. Now, the basic ingredients. You want 1 cup of shortening, my mother said. I use a stick of butter and a stick of margarine. You need 1 cup of white sugar, 1 cup of brown sugar. I like light brown sugar. You need 2 eggs. You need 2 cups of flour. And in the flour, you want to add 1 teaspoon of baking soda and 1/2 teaspoon of baking powder and 1/2 teaspoon of salt. Then you need 2 cups of rolled oats. You need 1 teaspoon of vanilla or more and 1 package of chocolate chips. And I also use 2 cups of crushed cereal like cornflakes or these are frosted flakes. Any kind of cereal like that helps. It's double the amount of cereal my mom used to put in the cookies, but I like the way they come out at the end, the texture. Now, that's the basic recipe. Beyond that, there are no rules. My mother, I don't think, ever put booze in her cookies, but for years I've been putting Grand Marnier in my cookies. And during the pandemic, I happened to try some of this Maggie's Farm pineapple rum, and it's become a favorite flavor in the cookies as well. And in the last batch I made, I added some bullet rye whiskey as well, along with the pineapple rum. And I like the way the rye lingers at the end of the cookies. And then there are the new ingredients. I got some figs from the green market in Bloomfield, and I chopped them into little chunks. I got some nice dried strawberries at DeLallo's and Jeanette. I have added macadamia nuts when I can get them. Sometimes they require some extra chopping. and some dried blueberries too, and a big handful of dried ginger chopped up as well. Things my mom would never have thought to put in her cookies. Let's see if we can get these started. You first go with the butter and margarine and add the sugars, and you'll want to cream them together, both the white sugar and the brown sugar. Then you add the two eggs, and it all starts to come together like a dough. Then it's helpful to turn the mixer off before you add the flour, and that's because you can add the flour and not have it fly everywhere, and the flour already has the baking soda, baking powder, and salt in it, and then you want to start this up again. And then it's time for the flavorings, and I decided I can go all in. First, a tablespoon of vanilla. Then I decided on a tablespoon of Grand Marnier, a tablespoon of pineapple rum, and a tablespoon of rye whiskey. That'll add lots of flavor. Once that's all nice and juicy, I'm going to add the 2 cups of rolled oats, followed shortly thereafter by my 2 cups of crushed cereal. Once you've added the chocolate chips, you're sort of home free. You've finished my mother's recipe. You can roll the dough into little balls and put them in the oven. But I've learned during the pandemic that you can also at this point start to experiment and add all kinds of things. You can add coconut, you can add toffee, you can add all kinds of dried fruits. I've added mangoes and strawberries and blueberries and all kinds of dates and raisins. You can also add nuts, pistachios, macadamias, whatever you've got on hand. I'm not going to tell you which ones to put in, because at this point, you know, you've got a really good thick dough. So once you've got the dough to the point where it looks like everything's put together, then you want to take it off the mixer, and we're going to start my least favorite part of the whole process, which is rolling the dough into small balls. I roll them in about the size of a golf ball, and I put them usually in a couple of different containers that'll fit in the refrigerator or the freezer, because you want to let them sit usually overnight. When you're ready to actually bake the cookies, then you've got to get your cookie sheet, and I put parchment paper down, and I space them apart. You know, I put 12 actually on a cookie sheet, and you put them into an oven that's been preheated to 325, maybe 330, and I cook them for about 15 minutes. I eyeball them, make sure they're okay. When I get the cookies out of the oven, I like to set them there for a second and maybe put a little bit of salt on top. I don't do it to all of them because some people don't like the salt, but I think it adds an extra dimension. And then you've got to let the cookies cool for a while, but I think in the end, if you follow all this and you have a good time and experiment, you'll end up with a mighty cookie. Well, I usually give away most of the cookies, although I always try to save a few for Santa, the great cowboy in the sky, because I think he truly appreciates them. Now, I think we've probably been concentrating too much on Christmas. One of the things I love about our program, Happy Holidays in Pittsburgh, is that it includes other celebrations as well that often occur at the end of the year. Now, it was a little bit unusual in 2001. Ramadan happened in November and December, and we were lucky enough to be invited to break the fast one night at the Muslim Community Center in Monroeville.
And everyone breaks the fast with dates and a snack or two.
Most people, I think when they think of fasting, it's kind of a dreary subject, okay? For the Muslim, you know, we're getting closer to our Lord, okay? Nothing stops for us. We continue to work. So it's not a dreary time for us. It's a time in which we're happy.
And on another night, we got to spend the evening with a family in Brookline.
Ramadan is a time of the year where we basically observe the fasting from sunup to sundown. It is a happy holiday because for Muslims it's a month of blessing.
Back then in 2001, we also got to celebrate Hanukkah in several different locations, starting at the Jewish Community Center in Squirrel Hill, where people gathered then without masks or any social distancing.
I wish you happy Hanukkah.
Welcome everybody to the lighting of the candles for the first night of Hanukkah. Okay? What's going to happen is that we are going to symbolically light this beautiful menorah up here with a torch that symbolically comes from Israel. And then we're going to sing the blessings together.
It's a community event with a real flame carried up close to the menorah, but it is all symbolic because the nine candles here are electric. The first light is called the shamas, which is the candle that's used to light all the others, one more each night. Families have various ways of celebrating the holiday.
Sometimes we have a Hanukkah party on Hanukkah, and sometimes we just get presents and light the candles. There's 8 days of Hanukkah.
On the seventh day, David and Janice Silverman in Churchill invited us to their place.
It's family and friends. It's a good time. It's a good celebration.
Happy Hanukkah!
Happy Hanukkah!
Similar to Christmas, it's a time where family and friends get together and enjoy themselves. And
my friends are not Jewish, so we wanted to include them in a really wonderful event for us.
The Silvermans and some of their guests have brought menorahs, and everyone gathers to light the candles. This holiday actually commemorates an unusual event in 165 BC, when Jewish warriors beat an occupying army in Jerusalem. They then reclaimed and rededicated their holy temple. The word Hanukkah means dedication in Hebrew. As part of the rededication, they found only a small amount of holy oil, but when they lit it, it amazingly burned and gave light for 8 days.
As a religious holiday, it may not be in the hierarchy. It's not like Yom Kippur or Rosh Hashanah. But this is more of a joyous holiday, very fun, very festival of lights.
Randy, did you bring your homemade applesauce?
Of course, it's a festival with foods, too.
Some of the traditional foods are foods that are cooked in oil, such as the potato latkes or potato pancakes.
A traditional latke is just potato. Potato, onion, egg. And then you fry it.
We're playing gyrado. Gyrado is a game where you put in gout.
You guys have to put one in. Everyone put one in.
And you spin a gyrado, and there's different letters to see what you got.
What'd you get?
Gilo!
It's an old game of chance, and there are Hebrew letters on the four sides of the dreidel, the spinning top, and each one has a meaning in the game.
If you get a gimel, you get all the gel in the pile. If you get a hay, you get half of it. And if you get shin, you have to put in two. And if you get none, you get none.
They ante up with what look like shiny gold coins.
It's supposed to be money, but it's chocolate.
On the last night of Hanukkah, we stopped in at Temple Sinai on Forbes Avenue for the big party there, organized by the women of the congregation.
This is our annual Hanukkah party that we run. It's a family event. The party tonight is for families, kids and their parents and grandparents.
James Gibson is the senior rabbi here.
We have 200 parents and kids all running around doing art projects, doing picture frames.
This seems to be the most popular table. The kids are creating a Hanukkah menorah out of lifesavers, and so they can eat it as they're doing it.
People are enjoying just being with their kids and celebrating here at the Temple Sinai family.
There's no question. All of these celebrations include family gatherings, and that's why this year the virus may make this all very unusual and subdued. I think family gatherings may be smaller, may include online components. But that's why I like looking at these clips that remind us all of what it's like to celebrate when there is no virus. Now, just after Christmas, a lot of African American Pittsburghers celebrate what's called Kwanzaa.
Kwanzaa is a cultural holiday celebrating our family, our community, and culture, and the strength and the legacy of our African ancestral roots.
The observance of Kwanzaa involves a mixture of social, cultural, and personal activities. like here at the home of Patricia Pugh Mitchell.
We'll begin now with our candle lighting ceremony. Tonight we are celebrating the sixth principle of Kwanzaa, which is Kumba, creativity. And we are also coming together as family and friends and having our caramu feast. And we come together to observe the seven principles of Kwanzaa, the Nguzu Saba, and just a time of reflection.
We also went over to the Cathedral of Learning at Pitt, where Professor Lawrence Glasgow from the History Department met us in the African Heritage classroom. He knows some history of this relatively new celebration.
It was started in 1966 by a man on the West Coast, Los Angeles, by the name of Ron Karenga, who was a cultural nationalist. He founded it right after the Watts riots of 1966. It started out as a way, an affirmation of black nationalism, black separatism. By the 80s, interesting things begin to happen to Kwanzaa. One, women take it over, turn it into a type of a family celebration, not a political, cultural, nationalist activity.
The third principle, Ujima, represents collective work and responsibility.
It changed in that as the women took it over, it became not so much hostile to Christianity, but it was seen as supplementary to or complementary to, sort of a soul Christmas, if you will. And Kwanzaa now has become a way of celebrating African-American identity.
I pray for life, for the
Well,
people.
Pat Mitchell used to be the executive director of the cultural organization called Kumba Trust, which worked on a special Kwanzaa event with the Carnegie Museum of Art.
In the year 2000, we invited Dr. Milana Karenga to come and kick off our citywide Kwanzaa celebration. He gave a lecture at Carnegie Music Hall in Oakland, and we had over 700 people in attendance. You know, to have the actual founder of Kwanzaa in your hometown is no small feat. And it's a good feeling, and it ties appropriately in with the other holidays, with Christmas and with Hanukkah, and it's all about family.
You know, all of these celebrations include family. They usually include some form of light, some food, and often music. And here at WQED, we used to do a series of programs called Holiday Jam. And I found a tape from 2007 that included a song by one of my favorite Pittsburgh bands, the Beagle Brothers.
Well, you thought that what a fool I am, but never would have got my hat. Call my lawyer, call my pa, I need a little money real bad. Spend my time at the jailhouse cell with the rats and the people coming down. Folks bleeding all over the place, somebody burn the jailhouse down. Well, I'm all alone for Christmas. I'm on my hotel near staying. I got time to kill when I'm over the hill. And I'm all alone on Christmas Day. Wonder if she's missing all the things I do and the crazy little things I used to say. Nobody loves you when you're down and out, and Jesus hears you when you pray. Call me if you ever have a dime and you find you need a little company. It's a long time coming, it's a short time gone. My baby put the chains on me. I'm all alone for Christmas. I'm on my hotel New Year's Day. And I got time to kill, and I'm over the hill. And I'm all alone on Christmas Day. Boys, I can never go back, and I'm telling you now it's true. Well, I can wrap my arms around nothing else, and I'll put another mile in my shoes. Well, it sure gets cold in old Bluefield, but it gets in my pretty when it snows. It's the brighter days and happy holidays from all our big old bros. Well, I'm all alone for Christmas. I'm on my hotel New Year's Day. And I've got time to kill,
and I'm over the hill.
And I'm all alone on Christmas Day. Trust his driver, don't ever look back. And I said, oh, old lady, I owe.
I'm Coco.
And I'm Joe.
You know, the Beagle Brothers can come sing Christmas carols at my house any year. I love that. The song that they sang, Alone for Christmas, was originally sung by a band from Austin, Texas called the Bad Livers. And the Beagle Brothers adapted it and added some new lyrics. Now, I've got one more clip from Happy Holidays in Pittsburgh. 2001, we were invited to the home of Guy Costa in Squirrel Hill, where every year he and his wife, Kathy Niederberger, put together the giant Italian feast of the seven fishes on Christmas Eve.
We invite different relatives and friends to come over for dinner, and it's a long-standing tradition that my dad had and my grandparents had now, and we're trying to carry it on.
It's the immediate family, which means Grandma Costa, her children and grandchildren, and then several of the cousins and Aunt Anita. So it's very nice.
Mom and I spent the day down in Strip District buying everything.
The boys are all great cooks. Joe's a good cook. Of course, Joe works with food. And Jay's a good cook. They all are.
I decorate the table. In fact, one of our cousins, Michelle, couldn't come in from California this year. But last year, she bought a whole bunch of linens that we'll use every year. So this year, we're inaugurating the new Christmas linens.
My dad and his two brothers owned a grocery store. It was called Costa Brothers. It was in the Lincoln Larmor section of the city. And during the holidays, my dad ran the fish department.
My husband was a big, he was always a big traditional person, you know. And he was known for feeding people. He loved to feed people.
Right now I'm working on the shrimp.
And the calamari and the smelts.
The fried shrimp is out here.
And the bacala.
We're going to do bacala two ways. One way we're going to fry that, and also we're going to, my mom made a bacala salad for my brother Joe, because Joe loves bacala salad.
And the crab meat. We have stuffed flounder with crab meat.
And then we're going to do smelts. And I'm not a big smelts eater, but my mom will do the smelts.
This is flour and cheese. And then we just quick fry them.
We're going to have mushroom stuffed with crab meat.
These are stuffed artichokes.
The clams. We have clam sauce.
We're going to have linguine with clam sauce. So that gives us our seven fishes for today.
I like all this fish.
In that story about the seven fishes, we didn't even mention the eggnog. That's why I've been going to the Costa Niederberger house for many years. You see, Kathy Niederberger and her son Joey Costa every year make some incredibly good eggnog, even during the pandemic.
We've been doing this for longer than Joe's been around, and he's almost 31, so probably around 35 years. It turns out that trying several recipes, my favorite recipe was the recipe in here, and it's called Holiday Eggnog.
Page 730.
Page 730 of the Culinary Arts Institute cookbook. And typically we make this shortly before Christmas, and we multiply by six. And that's how it goes. This year is a little different. 2020 is a little different of a year for us. And so we're making two batches this year.
Cracking the eggs, and then from there it separates in two processes with the egg yolks, which you have to put, you mix the egg yolks with a lot of sugar until they become like a lemony color.
You take that lemony blend of egg yolks and sugar, and to that you add all the alcohol. We put in 4 cups of rum, 4 cups of brandy, and 8 cups of bourbon.
Just a little bit of booze in this.
It's the holy trio. Bourbon, brandy, and rum really makes our eggnog delicious. Then you add the milk and the heavy cream, and you mix that all together till it's well blended together.
We always screw up somehow in terms of container size and have to transfer batches and eyeball it. Could get messy.
Yeah.
And you might have just seen us split into two pots that we were confident would work. We quickly realized that we do not have enough room for the milk and the egg whites. So fortunately, we think we figured it out with this big giant canning pot. And that should be able to fit everything, which will be the first time ever that everything is in one thing, one pot, equally mixed. All right.
Okay. And then separately, you have those egg whites that you beat till they're...
They show peaks.
They show peaks, but they're not stiff.
Look at that peak.
And then you fold that in. You fold it into the other mixture, and voila.
Yeah, there we go. It looks good.
You really want to get a good consistency. So it's best if you stir it longer than you think you need to.
Mm-hmm.
Because then it stays kind of creamy.
Right.
Otherwise, what happens is it separates.
We'll have to remember this next year.
Yeah, we actually did use it 1 year. I just completely forgot we even still have it. We do give it away. We drink it and we have it for meals, and we have certain folks that really look forward to it every year.
All right, let's try.
Okay. Unfortunately, this year, that's what made me just a little bit sad. So my mother-in-law, Louise Costa, loved the eggnog. My brother, Bob, loved the eggnog. Both of them have passed this year, so that's a bummer. And
more eggnog for us.
Yeah, that's true. The silver lining is more eggnog for us. This eggnog brings joy to people, and they look forward to it. Cheers to 2020.
Rough year, but...
It's a symbol of the holidays for us. It really is one of those things that only comes around for us one time a year.
Good. Yeah. Very good.
It's only here at Christmas time, and that's what makes it special.
How lucky am I? I have a glass of that eggnog right here. And I have some of this eggnog spice, and I can... gently dust it right on top of that, and looks great. I have a couple of my cowboy cookies right here, and I can add a couple of cypress flake salt on top of that, and these two little jars of spice can be yours. We're calling them WQED Season's Greetings. They can be yours as a thank you gift if you pledge right now at the $5 a month level. That's $60 a year. And it's a very simple process. You just go online on your computer or your phone to wqed.org, click on the donate button, and the instructions are there. It's very simple. Or you can just call the number on the screen and an operator will help you through the process. $5 a month gets you this special thank you gift. And you also get the satisfaction of knowing that you're supporting WQED and all the programs we make here, whether it be for holidays or for anything. We try to celebrate Pittsburgh and its history and all of the wonderful things that happen here. So you can do that. You can become part of WQED by just going to wqed.org or calling the number on the screen. And I have one more clip, a song. I thought we might end this where we began, with the Red Beans and Rice combo. They had to cancel their special Christmas show at the Northside Elks this year, but we all hope that they'll be back for a big celebration next year. Take us away, boys.
No, you don't come in until...
That's right, you do your thing at the beginning.
How'd you like to spend Christmas on Christmas Island? How'd you like to spend the holidays way across the sea? How'd you like to spend Christmas on Christmas Island? How'd you like to hang a stocking on a great big coconut tree? How'd you like to stay up late, like the islanders do? Wait for Santa to sail in with your presents in a canoe. If you ever spend Christmas on Christmas Island, you will never stray, for every day your Christmas dreams come true. Thank you.
think that's it. Thanks so much for watching. A big thanks also to editor Rich Capaldi, who put all these pieces together. Thanks also to David Bennett. Thanks to Kathy Niederberger and Joey Costa. Thanks to everybody in all the clips that we showed tonight. And happy Christmas to all, and to all, good health.